Okay, in this video, we'll go through some of the issues in growth, and then we'll go through the Malthus growth model. So first, growth is the increase in real GDP. And what we're really interested in is growth per capita. And the reason why we grow, and the reason why some countries are wealthier than others, is because of productivity. Productivity is what causes growth. Productivity is why some countries are wealthier than others. The reason why one country has a higher standard of living than another is because the workers in that country are more productive. We define productivity as really output, real output per worker. So output per person, and usually 1 hour is used for the amount of time, because if we want to compare countries, wealthier countries tend to work less hours per week than the poor countries. In this country, we're working 40 hours a week or a little less. Many of the developed countries are working 6 days a week, 60 hours a week, 6 days a week. And so you can't really compare what one worker can do in a week in one country and what another worker can produce in a week in a developed country, because they're not working the same amount of hours. So we're looking at it as output per labor, usually measured in 1 hour. Now there's a difference here between income and growth. Wealthier countries aren't necessarily growing faster. They may have grown faster in the past, but the reason why one country is up here in their income per person, the standard of living, and another one is down here, is productivity. Now, to grow, you have to increase worker productivity. So if everyone grows at the same rate, like this, the poor countries will always be behind. In order for poor countries to catch up, they have to grow faster. The growth rate of the productivity has to grow faster. So in other words, they're down here, we're here. In order to catch up with a developed country, they have to start growing faster than the developed countries in order to catch up. Looking at countries to see if they're going to catch up or not is a subject of convergence. Like, will the poor countries catch up with the richer countries? And that's one of the issues in growth. The main issues are, what causes growth? I mean, we know it's increases in worker productivity, but what causes worker productivity to increase? So what causes growth? And it's not clear. There's a whole lot of things that come up with growth and what's correlated with growth. Remember, the production function is that output is some function of total factor productivity and capital and labor. If we're looking at increasing output, we've got to increase capital, or something at A, total factor productivity. Then the second issue is, why do some countries grow faster than others? And the third issue, as I mentioned, is, will the poor countries catch up to the rich countries? Or are they growing faster than the richer countries so that they can catch up? So do poor countries grow faster than rich countries. And this is the issue of convergence. The answers to these questions are not easy. The main reason what causes growth for the developed countries is technology. So for number one, it's technology. The better technology we have, the increases in technology makes us more productive. And when workers are more productive, they can produce more. Now, why do some countries grow faster than others? Why have some been growing slowly and others growing fast? The main reason for that is bad governments, bad government policies. They've got some kind of government system that just doesn't work. You know, it's not conducive to entrepreneurship. Maybe they're not trading enough. Maybe it's corrupt. Maybe they don't have good property rights. A number of reasons, but it's usually some bad policies in the government. For number three, the jury is still out. Some countries are catching up. South Korea is caught up. China's catching up. Some countries are just getting further behind. Overall, for the world as a whole, it looks like convergence isn't happening, unfortunately. Some of the poorer countries are just getting further and further behind. Okay. The first growth model, really, that came out was due to Malthus. And this was prior to the Industrial Revolution. And he thought that output, real output, is a function of labor. More labor, more output. They really didn't have any machines then. And he drew this. We put Y on a vertical axis and labor down here. He knew that as we add more labor, we can produce more output. But there's diminishing returns to labor. So if we graph this, it's going to look something like this. Yeah, labor increases, but double labor, you don't get double output, diminishing returns. He also created another graph. And this is called the subsistence line. And this shows, we'll put labor down here, the amount of income we need to keep people from starving to death. So we'll put Y over here. And for any number of people in the economy, this would say at this number of people, we would have to have at least an output of this amount for them to survive. And for this amount of output here, or labor here, we're going to have this amount of output for these people to survive. So up in this range here, above it, above the subsistence line, we're producing more than enough to keep people alive. Below it, we're not producing enough for people to even have enough to eat. So this is below subsistence. And if we're below subsistence, people die from starvation. So people die. If we're producing above subsistence, then not only do people not die of starvation, but they produce more offspring. And the population will increase. Now we can put both of those on one graph. Put it right here. Since we have labor here and Y here, we've got this subsistence line. We have this production function, which is based entirely upon labor. And right where the two curves cross is an equilibrium. We'll call it L star. And the output that they create with L star, we'll call that Y star. It's an equilibrium there because at any other level of population, it's going to move away towards that equilibrium. So if we have a population, we'll say below L star down here, we'll call it L1 or L low. We can see that we need this amount here for everyone to survive. But we can produce this amount here. So we can produce more than we need, and the population increases, and L increases. If we're above the subsistence line, above L star, we're out here, we'll call this labor high number of people. We can go up to the graph. We can see this is the amount that we produce with that number of people. But up here, this is the amount we need to produce to keep everyone from starving. So when the population is high at L sub high, people starve and the population starts to shrink to the left and continues to shrink until we get to L star. So L star is an equilibrium. And that equilibrium is that we just produce just enough output to keep everyone from starving. We keep everyone at just the subsistence line. It's a pretty pessimistic prediction. This is called a Malthusian equilibrium. And I think it's why economics was termed the dismal science, because it has some rather dismal predictions about the future, that we're all going to be living at just subsistence level, barely enough to survive on as our equilibrium. The mistake that Malthus made here was that he left out any kind of technology. He left out capital, machines, and he left out technology increasing. So this was late 1700s, before the Industrial Revolution. The next model really was in the 1950s, which is the Solow model, which we'll go over in the next video. And what Solow did is he added in capital to the model and made capital endogenous in the model. And he also added in technology.